quickly before we start, if I could ask you please check your cell phone and make sure that it's on silent. And to let you know that we will be recording this session. So it's my sincere pleasure today to welcome Dr. Janice Kuechel-Glaser to this research event. Jan holds a PhD in clinical psychology and is currently the director of the Institute for Behavioral Medicine Research at The Ohio State University. And I had the pleasure of working with her for a year, not directly with her, but in the same group. She is the S. Robert Davis Chair of Medicine and also a Distinguished University Professor of Psychology. Jan is a member of the National Academy of Sciences and is listed as one of the most highly cited scientific authors in the world. She has authored more than 250 articles, chapters, and books detailing the consequences of stress across the lifespan. And her research includes unraveling the association between stress and impaired immunity, as well as the acceleration of age-related inflammation by chronic stress. Recently, she's expanded her research to explore the interaction between stress and depression in the context of daily stress and marital discord, with a focus on fatty acid metabolism and obesity. Jan, the reason she's here today, she's made an immeasurable contribution to the fields of psychoneuroimmunology and to the field of biobehavioral health. With a focus on immunity, she was one of the first to take the age-old notion that the mind affects health and provide us with empirical proof that this is indeed the case. Dr. Chris Coe, who was a BBH colloquium speaker back here in February, he commented to me that Jan and her husband, the virologist Ron Glaser, they've probably done more to advance the field of PNI than the rest of the researchers in that field combined. Thought you'd like that. At least half of our BBH colloquium speakers this year have cited Jan in their talks on their slides. And her papers are commonly assigned as required readings for our graduate students throughout their various courses. I think all of our students here are very well acquainted with her work. This is how central and how important Jan's work has been to our field, the field of biobehavioral health. So it is a true honor to have her here today, and please join me in welcoming Dr. Jan Kuechel-Glaser.
Today, I want to start by story starts back in 1988, when I got a call from Dr. Enid White of the National Institutes of Health. Enid had seen some work we were doing with medical students. We're at Ohio State, where we were getting blood from students on a lower stress day and then on the day of an exam. And we could watch immune function cycling over these higher and lower stress periods. And Enid said, you should be studying caregivers. Well, in 1988, I had no notion of what caregiving meant or what that meant. But as she described caregiving, I could see why it was an important research question. If we think about stress and having three components that make the particular a bit difficult, unpredictability, uncontrollability, and loss, and caregiving captures all of that in spades. So, seemed like a good idea, and through working with Enid, we, for the next 20 years, then studied caregivers. It was a major thrust for One Direction in our lab, helped along by a merit award. But one of the first questions we were struggling with was, how do you measure health relevant outcomes? Because there we can measure a lot of facets of the immune response, but what does that actually mean in terms of health? Well, Rob had a really good idea. He said, we should use a vaccine. You can give everybody the same dose of something useful. You can look at how well they're able to respond to the vaccine, and it gives you a nice window in terms of how they respond in daily life. So if we begin by using an influenza vaccine with caregivers compared to very well-matched non-caregivers. So we vaccinated everybody, and we found clearly that the caregivers in blue were less able to respond to the vaccine than the controls, the non-caregivers in red. But in fact, that was only part of the story, because what you can clearly see is that aging magnified that effect big time. It's one of the themes that's really grown in the literature now, that aging really magnifies the effects of stress on the immune response. If you think of it this way, your immune response declines with age. If you're 18, then perhaps you have a glass that's this full, all the way to the top. When you get to 65 or 70, perhaps it's only two-thirds, maybe half full. So you don't want to spill any more out of it. So if stress is taking more out, you reach a point of greater risk. Now, some of you may be younger and obviously not caregivers and thinking, well, this really doesn't apply to me. Well, one of our other studies with our medical students was giving our students hepatitis B vaccine before it became commonplace when it was brand new. We found that students who were medical students who were more stressed, more anxious, took significantly longer to develop a protective antibody response to the vaccine. Here's another study with vaccine. This is a pneumococcal pneumonia vaccine in this case. Caregivers here in yellow are able to respond to the vaccine initially at 2 weeks, as well as former caregivers in red or controls. But what happens over time is the caregivers at 6 months are no longer able to maintain the same protective antibody response. There's a diminution in their ability to maintain the response. And now that's true of what we know in a whole variety of studies now. Multiple labs have shown that stress can alter both the antibody and the T cell response to a variety of vaccines. This is a nice proxy for what happens in terms of exposure to infectious illness. Thank you. Let's see. I've got it. Better? Okay. So multiple labs have shown that, in fact, you can alter responses to vaccines. So many of you hopefully had a flu vaccine last fall. Do you remember how you felt, your emotional temperature, on the day you had that vaccine? Because it may tell you something about how long it took you to respond to the vaccine, and in some cases, whether you actually responded or not. We wanted to look at other facets of the immune response that would be related to health, and we wanted to see health-related outcomes. We were trying to figure out what would be good health-related outcomes to consider. Phil Marupa, who was a member of our group, feeling it would be a really good outcome to study. At that time, we were actually at a meeting at NIH, seated around a table discussing health relevant outcomes. I nudged him and I said, keep quiet, let's go home and talk about this ourselves at home. So we went back as a group and we talked about how we could create a good wound healing model for what we might want, and how we could actually study wound healing. I spent several months going through Medline trying to find good surgical models for wound healing. I went through a whole bunch of surgical literature. I went through all kinds of literature, and I couldn't find anything because surgeons have a truly unfortunate habit of closing wounds, suturing wounds closed after surgery. We want to look at wound closure. So we decided that there was only one reasonable and viable explanation, viable alternative. So we began wounding people. We used the punch biopsy, like you see here, to create a small pencil eraser size wound on the arm. And we measured how long it took to heal, again, caregivers and very well-matched non-caregivers. And our caregivers took 24% longer than very well-matched non-caregivers to heal exactly the same small standardized wound. That was bigger than we expected and certainly substantial. It's an effect that's been really well replicated in a variety of studies now. And actually, one of the studies we went on that Phil, again, from Maruka, pioneered, Phil was a periodontist and immunologist, Phil is actually. He's in Oregon. And he recruited dental students for an oral wound placed on the hard palate. So touch your tongue, you lift your mouth on the side. And what he did was use that same punch biopsy to create a wound on one side of the mouth at the end of summer vacation, and on the other side, 3 days before the first major exam of the term. So each student is serving as his or her own control. Now, when I talk about this study, people often wince. But the type ratings were really low. But then someone came up to me after a talk and they said, these are dental students. They're creating all wounds. You don't really think they're going to report pain to you, which I thought was a good point. So here are the data for those 11 students. The red bar is their vacation wound, and then the crosshatch bar is their wound placed 3 days before exams. What you can see is that no student healed his or her own wound as rapidly during exams as they did following summer vacation. In fact, some students took twice as long to heal exactly the same small standardized wound. Stress has really big effects on wound healing. Chris here is an expert in this area these days. This was older work from our lab, but he can certainly tell you a lot more about it than I ever could. But it was really clear it made a difference. You can think about it in your own mind now. If you were fortunate enough to cut yourself shaving, for example, this morning, you now have a wound that you can follow over time and see how long it takes to heal. Well, I thought we were the first to actually document the effects of stress on wound healing. And we were, in fact, in terms of controlled studies. But then George Crosus, who was at the NIH at the time, came up with this quote that I hadn't seen before. Oliver Wendell Holmes was a surgeon during the American Civil War. And it's a really poignant quote that the same wound received in battle will do well in the soldiers that have beaten, that would prove fatal in those that have just been defeated. Well, infection and trauma can trigger the inflammatory response. If you're wounded, if you're infected, you need to have a good inflammatory response. It's an important part of healing. But what you don't want is chronic or persistent inflammation, because that poses additional risks. Look at the diseases and disorders listed on the slide, and think about how many of those are represented in your own family. It would be a really rare family that didn't have any of them, because they're all so commonplace. And they're all inflammation associated. It's become one of the major themes in a lot of the literature, medical literature, over the past couple of decades in particular. And one of the exciting a toothpaste man. Perhaps 10 years ago, I was talking to a periodontist in Ohio State, and I said to her, I don't understand this big buzz about why there's this connection between periodontal disease and cardiovascular disease. She looked at me as if I were more than slightly dense, and she said, think of it this way. If you have periodontal disease, you have a fist-sized wound in your mouth that's not healing. It's a source of infection. So tonight, when you go home, you're tired, you're thinking about whether or not you want to floss and brush. I want to remember that fist-sized wound. But seriously, the kinds of infections here are in themselves seemingly trivial, but persistent infections are in fact a source of inflammation. So we can go down that slope there, stress and depression, to immune dysregulation, to an enhanced risk of infection, prolonged infections, and delayed wound healing, and then to increased inflammation. But we also know now that there's really ample evidence, I wouldn't have to tell this group, that stress and depression fuel inflammation themselves. That the work back in the 1990s originally by Michael Mays, who started it, showed that major depression was associated with increased pro-inflammatory cytokine production. Subsequently, a number of different labs have shown depressive symptoms or depressed moods. And then I'll talk a little about chronic stressors like caregiving and acute stressors. So what that means is we not only can go straight down from there to there, but we also can go directly from stress and depression to increased inflammation. This was a nice study done by Chris Fagundes when he was in my lab. He's now at Rice in Texas. Looking at responses to the Dreher Social Stress Test in people who have relatively low levels of depressive symptoms. I think most of you are familiar with the Dreher, but just in case. Basically, you bring a person into your laboratory, you tell them they're going to be asked to do a talk for about 5 minutes on something like why they should be the best candidate for a particular job that they've never held before. You give them 5 minutes to prepare. They come in and they find facing them two or three people in white coats who they're told are experts in behavioral evaluation and will be evaluating their talk. So the person starts talking and the white-footed people sit there staring without expression. So they keep talking and the people just sit there and look and watch them. If they stop talking, the panel will say, please continue. At the end of 5 minutes, they do mental arithmetic. So that white-footed chance from 2,225 as rapidly as you can. Every time they make a mistake, you say, error, the correct response is. So it's obviously a really nice stressor, as long as you're not on the receiving end. But what you see is that even with relatively mild levels of depressive symptoms, following the Dreher, we get more of a boost in terms of IL-6 here. Yeah, I keep going up, compared to those with lower levels of depressive symptoms. So that people who are already stressed have the opportunity to produce even more pro-inflammatory cytokines. So what happens with chronic stress? That was one of the questions that we wanted to answer. So we had caregivers and non-caregivers, non-caregiving controls. We had two blood samples a year for 6 years. And we followed those people, we looked at what happened over time in terms of IL-6. For those of you who are not immunology types thus far, it's an important marker for inflammation. That's all you really need to know about it. What we found was that our caregivers here, compared to our non-caregivers, really had a much steeper increase. Their rate of increase in IL-6 was about 4 times as great related to their age down here as that those of very similar controls. That was only part of the story. One of the reviewers said, well, what might that mean in terms of health? So I spent a lot of time in the literature cursing the reviewer and trying to figure out what I was saying. And what I found was that some of the area of risk for the upper quartile. So when I applied that level, that value to our data, and looked at where our subjects would fall, it would mean that our caregivers would cross that line sometime around age 75. Our controls would cross that line somewhere after age 90. So there would be a 15-year difference in terms of how long, in terms of age-related differences in information that were associated with all those age-related diseases that you were seeing earlier. Really have an effect. Well, if that's true, then you might expect to see that there are differences in mortality associated with caregiving. And in fact, that was true in a very nice study by Rich Schultz and Beach that was published in JAMA, showing that strained caregivers had 63% higher mortality over 4 years than non-strained caregivers or non-caregiving controls. I was really honored when JAMA invited me to write an editorial to accompany the paper where I talked about how some of our data really provide mechanistic explanations for how those effects might occur. What happens when caregiving ends? Well, with bereavement, we know that typically within the first year or two, we grieve up oftentimes. But after 2 years, we don't expect people to look that different in terms of bereavement from people who haven't been bereaved. That's what the literature says. So that caregivers should know no different than non-caregivers 2 years after the spouse's death. Well, in our longitudinal study, we selected people who were at least 3 years post-bereavement and compared them with people who had been continuously caregiving. So here are controls from before. Here are the former caregivers on the dotted line, and here are the current caregivers. So why would there be no recovery? Well, there are two explanations, and they're not mutually exclusive. One is biological, that in fact what may have happened is an acceleration of the aging of the immune response that may not go back to baseline. The second is psychological. What happens, we've seen in our data and data from other studies, caregivers lose parts of their social network. Post-caregiving, they have smaller networks. They still report greater loneliness than non-caregivers, and they have higher levels of depressive symptoms. They've lost part of their social life, and for an older adult, it's not like a college student who can go out, meet someone new in a class, and have a couple of new friends. It becomes harder and more difficult to get social connections. And so that also could be happening. But those two explanations may account in part for the lack of recovery that we're seeing. But one of the things I'm doing here is something that I've learned since I should never have done. Steve Zaret has done, I think he's the father of caregiving research, has done some really, really elegant work. And one of the famous lines that I got from Steve is that caregiving is not a disease, meaning that if people are not equally affected by caregiving, there are certainly variations in how people are affected. I think the average caregiver is probably, dementia caregiver is probably more stressed than a non-caregiver. There's very wide gradations in that spectrum. And one of the things then we became interested in was the telomeres. These have been in the news over the last 10 to 15 years, especially since Elizabeth Blackburn won the Nobel Prize for her work on telomeres. And one of the things that's so interesting about telomeres is the relationship with inflammation. So inflammation helps to shorten telomeres. The analogy that's often used is you think of the chromosome and the bit of DNA on the end of it, it's like being like a shoelace with the cap on the shoelace. As you lose more and more of the cap on the shoelace, you see the chromosome, you see the end fraying until it becomes non-functional. And so the more cells divide, the more DNA is lost, and you get cell senescence. And shorter telomeres have been linked to many, many health behaviors like obesity and smoking, as well as aging, age-related diseases, and mortality. Well, Elizabeth Eppel first showed in 2004, along with Elizabeth Blackburn, that mothers who were caregiving for a child with problems had shorter telomeres than non-caregivers or stressed mother caregivers. We replicated this effect in dementia caregivers. But then we found something else. We wanted to look at early life stress and longer-term risks because, as I was talking with one of the students earlier, one of the big issues in the literature these days is what the long shadow that social adversity and early abuse causes. We know from a lot of literature there's an enhanced emotional sensitivity to stress. People who've been abused or had adverse childhoods are more likely to develop psychiatric disorders, especially depression, when they're stressed. And they have higher levels of inflammation on average. We were looking here at childhood adversities before age 16. Any of these adversities, the death of a parent, severe parental marital problems, etc. About a third of our sample had at least one adversity, 23% had two or more. And that's pretty common in samples of this type in terms of the numbers. People actually think it's underreported because people are less likely to report abuse or neglect or adversity. So we went back to that sample of caregivers where we showed a difference between our caregivers and our non-caregivers. In this case, we're controlling for everything, including caregiver status. We're looking here at people who've had no adversities, one adversity, or two or more adversities. And so the early childhood adversities are actually overshadowing the effects of caregiver stress on telomere length. And the difference between those who have had adversities and two or more could translate into a 7 to 15 year difference in lifespan. So the early adversity literature has really been showing just how important early adversity can be. Well, part of what I had in my pilot was remedies for stress. And perhaps the best thing we know in terms of remedies would be strong social relationships. Across a variety of studies, we know that strong personal relationships are associated with better outcomes. In our earlier studies with caregivers, those who had better social support had less negative immune changes over time. I've had a series of marital studies that Ron and I conducted where we showed that people whose marriages were more contentious or unhappy had poorer immune function than those with happier marriages. A very large literature in general shows that strong social connections are protective during stress and make a difference in terms of longevity. This is a nice meta-analysis that's probably unreadable from there, but the top three bars are social relationships, overall findings from the meta-analysis. The second line is high versus low social support in relationships. And the third bar here is social relationships, complex measures of social integration. And then we're comparing the effect size then in terms of mortality risk with smoking, with smoking cessation, with alcohol consumption, flu vaccine, pneumonia mortality, rather, cardiac rehab, effects of cardiac rehab for patients with coronary heart disease, physical activity, BMI, drug treatment for hypertension, or air pollution. So then in terms of the mortality risks associated with all of those, strong social relationships really carry a lot of freight. They're really, really important. Well, another issue we have in terms of stress is that when we're stressed, we tend to engage in behaviors that can fuel inflammation. We sleep more poorly. We likely exercise less. Comfort food becomes incredibly appealing. People who smoke will smoke more, and alcohol abuse becomes more common. This is a nice slide from the goddess that I've always liked, comparing very youngish men and women, ages 19 to 34, and they're deprived of sleep for 2 nights per week. So here they are with all the sleep they need, and here they are when they've just been deprived 2 nights per week. And this is IL-6 again, that key pro-inflammatory cytokine that they're talking about. And even in these very young and healthy adults, we see that relatively mild sleep deprivation really has an effect on inflammation. If you think about your sleep in the last week, how many nights were you perhaps two hours under what you wanted? And what does your IL-6 look like today then? So, 10 or 15 years ago, I thought I was getting bored with everything I was doing, and I got interested in the intersection between stress, diet, and immune function. Because I knew that stress certainly affected immune function, diet affected immune function, and so what might be their interactive effects, especially related to inflammation? Because they both tap and go through the same pathways. So we have ways that they can interact and synergistically combine in the worst possible cases. So I began working with Martha Valeri, a wonderful colleague, nutritional colleague at Ohio State, who's a fatty acid person. And one of the things that caught my eye in the nutritional literature was some evidence that, some suggestion that there might be inflammation following high saturated fat meals. But it was a cloudy area and there were a lot of methodological issues, so it wasn't really clear. But what was clear in that literature was that in fact that there are differences in terms of the consequences in at least in vitro studies, certainly, and some in vivo studies as well, in terms of the kinds of fat in our diets. Palmitic acid, a saturated fatty acid, is the most common one in meat and dairy. And oleic acid, which is monounsaturated, is found in olive oil and many vegetable oils. And there's a substantial literature about how saturated fats can trigger pro-inflammatory signaling pathways. I'm not going to get into the biology there because it gets dense and I think probably more boring than you want to hear about. But there's been a lot of evidence that in fact saturated fatty acids could trigger inflammation through a variety of pathways. On the other hand, we know that with data from the Mediterranean diet, there's reduced inflammation. There's also a reduced risk for depression, for cardiovascular disease, for type 2 diabetes, and total mortality, all inflammation-associated conditions. And olive oil, the central fat source, is anti-inflammatory. So we thought, wouldn't it be cool to try to look at what actually happens in the laboratory, looking at differences in a couple of different meals? So what we call the food study had 58 women, 38 were breast cancer survivors, and 20 were benign controls. It didn't matter in any of our measures whether or not they were breast cancer survivors. It was a double-blind, randomized crossover design, where the women came in twice to our clinical research center, a hospital research unit. And during one admission, they get a hot meal high in saturated fat, and another, a high oleic sunflower oil. And we would draw a lot of blood from them during the next 7.5 hours. Well, this is what our meals look like, because this was a double-blind study. That is, those are scrambled eggs, sausage gravy, and biscuit. And it actually tastes reasonably good. I sampled the breakfast as part of when we were building this. The Clinical Research Center bio-nutrition staff worked really hard to develop these two meals that were equivalent in most ways, except for the kind of fat in them. These meals have 930 calories, 60 grams of fat, and 60% of the calories comes from fat. Now, people always say, well, I would never eat anything like that. I mean, that's outrageous. And we modeled it after common fast one where David Almeida actually should be giving me part here, because I really am a fan of his daily inventory of stressful events, the dice. And so think about this. This is what we were doing with our research participants in this food study. And we were first asking a series of questions about what they experienced in the last 24 hours. So think about it yourself. In the last 24 hours, did you have an argument or a disagreement with anyone? Anything happened that you could have argued about that you decided to let pass? In a variety of ways, we're asking, did you have stressful events that happened to you in the last 24 hours? And one of the really nice things about the measure is that it's objectively scored. So let's say I'm really histrionic and I say, a bad day. It's one of the worst possible days. That is not scoreable, then. The kinds of things that our women reported that were in fact scoreable was one woman talked about how her son had spilled paint on the floor, and she had spent several hours in the morning scrubbing up the paint. Another woman talked about how she was trying to deal with her mother, who was in an assisted living situation. And her mother didn't want to be there, and they had a great deal of conflict over the mother's placement. In a third case, a woman talked about she and her husband had been planning something for the latter part of the day and arranged childcare, and the childcare person canceled at the very last moment. And they had this frantic scramble about how they were going to do this, could they actually manage it, could they provide childcare, and it had been something that they didn't know they could work out or not. So those are the kinds of situations that make this horrible. So now that you're talking about, did you have anything happen? I'd like you to think about your diet, your stressors, and your mood over the last 24 hours. I'm a stress eater, so when I get stressed, I do tend to indulge in things I shouldn't. Yesterday, for example, I had a pint of ice cream. That's not something I would normally do. So what happens then with women who had no stressors or one or more stressors? What we're looking at here are some inflammatory markers that are related to cardiovascular disease. And they're all pretty much showing the same thing. ICAM1, VCAM1, CRP, that's C-reactive protein, and SAA. And what you see is that this is the high saturated fat diet. So if you didn't have any, it was not affected by stressors. For the high oleic diet, if you had no stressors, yeah, you were better off. If you did have stressors, it looked like you ate the saturated fat. And that was true across each of our markers. But basically, the advantage you had in a high oleic meal was canceled out if you had a stressor, one or more stressors. So when I presented this the first time, someone raised their hand and said, so what that means is if I'm having a bad day, I should have the best comfort food anyway because it won't matter. Let me emphasize the fact that neither of these meals is healthy. 930 calories, 60 grams of fat is not where you want to go. You can understand why it's so tempting, and you can also understand what may happen. But that's only part of the story, before I go on. So why do we care about those? Well, ICAM-1 and VCAM-1 are particularly associated with atherosclerosis, measures of both people who are not symptomatic, that may have plaque burden, or those who already may also serve as a prognostic indicator of cardiovascular disease. So in neither case, do you want to have higher levels of those? But this is the part of the rest of the story. So one of the things we've done too was we look at a variety of different measures in terms of metabolism. The day before we brought our people into the clinic coming in with the same kind of meal loading in the same way, so we could look at things like fat oxidation. This is not one of our subjects. This is Michael DiGregorio, my lab manager. And what he's showing you here is how you can measure metabolic rate and the data, and to make and how we're going to get the data here in terms of fat oxidation. So with fat oxidation, you want to oxidize fat, because if you're not oxidizing fat, you're storing fat. And what we're seeing here is with one stressor compared to no stressors, fat oxidation is lower. We have a very similar finding for insulin production. Again, it's another way to store fat. So that women who had one stressor or more had lower, had higher insulin production than those who didn't have any stressors. There were also differences, that particularly discouraging slide, in terms of metabolic rate. When women had no stressors, like here, one stressor, what you're seeing is a drop in their metabolic rate across the afternoon, across a 6-hour period when we're measuring. If we looked at the difference between one stressor and no stressors, it would be about 104 calories. That's trivial in the course of one day. If that happens daily or every few days, it becomes an issue, because it could add, daily would add 7 to 11 pounds per year. So that stress in a high-fat diet could, in fact, fuel the changes in metabolism that could lead to weight gain. At the same time, we're storing more fat and burning less fat. In this slide, what we're looking at are changes in triglycerides. So if you eat a high-fat meal and you get a rise in triglycerides, you want that rise to be as small as possible, and you want it to disappear as soon as possible, because it's associated with progression of atherosclerosis, higher rise and more lingering rise. Women who had both a history of depression as well as at least one stressor had the highest rise and the biggest response. So that we have a whole battery of measures that are suggesting that responsiveness to daily stressors is associated with differences in metabolic changes that could lead to obesity over time. We also have parallel data from a study with couples. So I know the data are immutable. We were able to replicate them conceptually in another related study where we actually brought couples in and created our own stressor by asking them to discuss a disagreement. Well, one of the important things to think about here is that we could only see these stress and depression related effects after we fed people a high-fat meal. We couldn't see those differences in the baseline data. So that it was really showing up related to what people were actually eating. The problem, of course, is when we're stressed, we usually don't reach for carrots. And our findings may well, in fact, underestimate the effect, because most of us eat every 4 to 5 hours. And we only feed once. So normally it would be kind of bump of the day. And so those adverse metabolic alterations then could persist across the day. So then we find that there's actually a substantial literature about the association between depression and stress and obesity. That across a variety of studies, there's an increased risk for having obese people who are depressed over time, and that when older depressed adults in one study gained visceral fat over 5 years, while non-depressed adults lost visceral fat. So that we could see some of the metabolic factors that may actually be fueling those changes. And the visceral fat is, belly fat especially, is among the most pathological. It's exactly where you don't want it in terms of metabolic risk. So, back to inflammation. Individuals with higher body mass index have higher levels of inflammation, up to 30% of IL-6, that cytokine may be produced by adipose tissue. So the heavier you are, the more your fat cells are inclined to be little cytokine factories unprovoked. go straight down here. From stress and depression to immune dysregulation to all of this, increased pro-inflammatory cytokine production. What we get with increased pro-inflammatory cytokine production are higher levels of depressive symptoms, greater fatigue, pain, and cognitive problems. Those are all products having higher levels of inflammation. So we can go straight down, but then there's also really nasty feedback loop. It goes straight back up. Well, physical activity is inversely associated with inflammation. There are many, many studies that show cross-sectionally and longitudinally that more active people have lower levels of inflammation. Exercise reduces depression and promotes better sleep. So there are a variety of pathways through which that could occur. So we decided to look in breast cancer survivors at an activity intervention. Inflammation is frequent among breast cancer survivors. It can be higher, can be boosted by cancer treatments. Physical activity typically declines during breast cancer treatment. Fatigue, which is associated with inflammation, is an important problem among breast cancer survivors and one of the inflammation-associated sickness behaviors. What we chose to do was yoga because we wanted an exercise that would be appropriate for a group of middle-aged and older women who might not have the interest or stamina for more vigorous exercise. It can provide graded exercise for individuals who are sedentary. So in one of those studies that I always regretted doing because it took so long, I'm so glad it ended and worked out well, we recruited 200 breast cancer survivors for at least 2 months to 3 years post-treatment. They were randomized to yoga or a weightless control. The yoga group met 12 weeks, twice a week, 90 minutes each time, and we ended up with a total of 25 yoga groups to get everybody in the study. What we found was that yoga, in fact, did reduce fatigue and depressive symptoms in our breast cancer survivors. This is the fatigue measure, and what we're seeing here are controls, and there's a dose response here in terms of less and more practice. This is vitality, so it's the inverse. Here are the controls, less practice, more practice. Here are depressive symptoms, exactly the same pattern. There's a dose-response relationship in terms of how often the women were actually practicing. More practice, greater benefit. We saw something very similar in terms of inflammation. Here are three different cytokines. IL-6, the one you keep hearing about, TNF-alpha, and IL-1-beta. You see the controls here, the lower practicers and the higher practicers over time, so that we can reduce fatigue, depressive symptoms, and inflammation through yoga practice. And I don't have the dose response part on here, but it was also true, yoga practice also improves sleep. We looked at a variety of explanations for why that might be. I'm going to go ahead of that slide. So basically, we looked at whether it was related to changes in weight. It wasn't. Changes in social support, no difference. Changes in loneliness, no. Changes where the group's different, because when you're doing randomization, you never know if you'll end up with a good randomization or not. The groups didn't differ on anything we could see. They differed in terms of yoga practice. People say, okay, so why is yoga working? What are the key ingredients? And we don't know. If you're a yoga person, you know that there are postures, there's breathing, and there's meditation component. And any or all of those may make a difference and probably do together. But we don't know what the most critical ingredients are if there are particular ingredients. I would have said that the body postures were the least important, but I saw a really nice mouse study recently by one of the Harvard, where she was showing that by injecting an inflammatory stimulus into the mouse along the spine and then having the mouth stretched, and I wish I had a picture to show you, reduce local inflammation, so a yoga bottle per mouse, compared to a mouse who did not stretch. So that whatever the active components are, they're there. So if yoga dampens or limits inflammation, regular practice could have substantial benefits. An earlier cross-sectional study we conducted, in fact, found that novice yoga practitioners had 40% higher IL-6, I think it was, if I'm saying this right, than experienced yoga practitioners who were very low match. So whatever is happening, it appears to be really useful. I had been very apprehensive when we got the data to analyze, because about two-thirds of the way through the study, I read a couple of reviews of the exercise literature, how exercise interventions reduced inflammation. And it was incredibly discouraging set of reviews, because they were saying unless people lost weight, that exercise interventions didn't appear to be reducing inflammation on any regular basis. And I thought, well, we're really cooked, and exercise won't do it. So I don't know why it is, in terms of why we're doing yoga, why many exercise interventions don't show. But it was an interesting difference in terms of a lot of what's out there. I have to give you a quick blurb on my institute, because I'm the director, and it's one of those things I'm obligated to do. It is a really cool group of people. Our mission statement, we function as an incubator to create and disseminate cutting-edge mind-body research that will enhance individual and community health. The kinds of work I'm describing are exemplars of what we do in the institute, that our strength is really in our diversity. We have so many disciplines represented that we're able to really do a lot of cool things. Bench to bedside is a phrase people talk about these days for translational research. And I think about it, does my research really matter? Does it make a difference in anyone's life? A couple of years ago, I went to see my internist for my annual physical. She asked how I was doing. And I said, well, to tell you the truth, I'm a bit stressed. She asked why. And I told her about Ron and Alzheimer's. And she said, you really need to watch your health. There's this research on caregiving and stress. and at that moment, I knew that our research had actually gone